Kiran, Dr. Vachani, Board of Directors, faculty, students, and the proud parents. I am really overwhelmed by the presence of some of the stars and the best minds of this country. This country is really, really proud of you. I know how difficult it is to get into this institution. If I add my marks from first standard till final year and multiply it by 100, still I wouldn't be getting into this institution. We are really proud of you. I'm sure most of you were the best outgoing students in your class. You're all occupying the front bench of the classroom. And before the teacher could complete the question, I'm sure you're all raising the hand with the answers. There are kids behind you occupying the back bench. And those kids were watching all of you. And they all thought that this world belongs to all of you, the rank holders, the blue ribbon, gold ribbon, and the rest of it. And in the game of life, in the real life, they generally think, and their parents think, that the backbenchers have very difficult chance in this world. But unfortunately, the world doesn't work like that. The institutions, companies, organizations which have changed the rules of the game, which made this world a better place, are generally built by children who are occupying the back bench. You know why they do it? Because they are not as clever as you. They simply didn't know it wasn't possible. Anyway, now you must be wondering which bench I was sitting. I wasn't sitting in any of those benches. I was given some special bench outside the class most of the time. How do I go back? Can you just... Yeah, but this one is it. Okay, thanks. Thanks. I just want to talk to you during the next few minutes about your life now that you have come out of the institution, great institution. You are going to do extremely well. You are going to do extremely, extremely well. Whatever you do, I'm sure you will succeed. But when you get into this mode of entrepreneurship, that you want to create something, one day you will get around with your friends in Cafe Coffee Day or one of those places and you discuss, I want to do something big. I want to create something which never existed before. Then the question comes around, what shall we do? Shall we start a software company? Shall we start a hardware company? Whatever. Once you decide on what you want to do, the next question is, you all want to discuss about how to do it. Where do we raise the money? Where do we put start the company? Shall we do it in India? Shall we do it in US? Wherever we do. But I have a sincere request. Ask yourself one more question. Why do we want to do it? When you ask that question with the passion, why you want to do it, and if that happens to be that why of it, if it is going to make this a better place to live, you will always succeed. And that is the power of purpose. There is nobody in this world who is better off than all of us. But people who achieve, they achieve because of the power of conviction. You heard of and you read so much about the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi. He was 5 foot nothing. He wasn't one of the greatest speakers. His father wasn't one of the richest men in this part of the world. And he could mobilize 600 million uneducated people who had no idea what freedom was to fight for the freedom. He could make them to die for the freedom. They didn't know what freedom was. And at a time when there was no mobile phone, there was no internet, there was no WhatsApp. All this happened because of his conviction. It is a power of purpose. If you decide one day to create something which is going to make this world a better place to live in, believe me, cosmic forces connive their way to make it happen. I would like to just talk about some of the incidences which happened in my life. We built a heart hospital with the idea that anybody in this world, with or without money, should be in a position to go for the heart operation. And we succeeded. Then one day we decided that we want to create a similar hospital for cancer treatment, which is very expensive. And I started the work, put the foundation, but then I realized it is too expensive to build a cancer hospital. So I shut the project. I was disappointed. Then one day I got a call from Kiran, my friend here. She said, "I believe you are interested in building a cancer hospital. Can I be of some help?" And I met her, and she gave me a check. She gave me a check for 30 crore rupees. And she had only one condition. It was not a business condition. She said she wants to build world's largest and world's best cancer hospital, which will never turn down anyone because of lack of money. And this is how Mazumdar Shah Cancer Center started. I was a young surgeon in Bangalore many years ago at Manipal Heart Foundation. I used to see large number of children with a heart problem. And I used to beg and borrow and do all kinds of things to raise money for their heart operation. And one day I received a check for 1 lakh rupees from a retired army major with a little note. The note said, "The path you have chosen, the money I am giving, is too small, but God has his own mysterious ways of giving you the rest." This is the power of purpose. So whatever you want to do, choose something which will make this world a better place to live in, and you'll be amazed at the way the society and the cosmic forces will come and help you. Never doubt that a small group of committed people can change the world. We always look at ourselves, our background, our family, our bank balance, our friends, our relatives. We feel that, how do I create something which can change the world? But it is possible, provided you're committed to it. In fact, Margaret Mead, one of the famous anthropologists, says that is the only thing which has changed the world. World has never been changed by groups of countries coming together and coming up with a slogan that let's change things. It is always a small group of committed people who change the world. I'll just give you an example in my own life. How today, today in the state of Karnataka, every citizen can undergo any operation for any disease without virtually paying for it. It happened 10 years ago. There was drought in the state of Karnataka. Farmers lost their capacity to buy healthcare because in our government spends 1% of the GDP on healthcare. People have to buy healthcare. So I collected some of my friends who are running the hospital. We came up with a concept that if large number of farmers pay just 5 rupees per month, 11 cents per month, they can have a health insurance which can cover the cost of any operation. And our government then had the wisdom to accept the concept. Because when you talk to a politician that with 5 rupees a month you can do a heart operation, first thing they will do is to test my brain. But the government had the wisdom to accept it. They made it like a state program, and government agreed to become a reinsurer. In the process of 10 years, 7,10,000 farmers had varieties of surgeries. 85,000 farmers had a heart operation just by paying 5 rupees per month. Now we are trying to convince the government. We have 850 million mobile phone subscribers who are spending at least 150 rupees per month just to speak on the mobile phone. If you can collect 20 rupees from each mobile phone subscriber, we can cover the health care of 850 million people. This is the power of India. This is the power of technology. This is the power of living in a country called India. And this is the opportunity waiting for all of you to explore. One day you will be discussing with your friends and family members to discuss about what kind of a company I create and how do I run my life. This is a famous saying from one of the African saying that if you want to walk fast, walk alone. But if you want to walk far, walk together. Always, whatever you want to do, always choose friends and companions, because none of us are as smart as all of us. Just want to tell you about a very interesting statement from the father of the nation. Anything you want to do in life, any company you want to join, any project you take up, ask yourself, is the step you contemplate going to be of any use to the poorest and the weakest man? Now, I may sound as if I am talking about the rights of the poor people and talking about addressing the poverty of the country. No, this is the best business strategy you can adopt. Any service, any product, if you design for the poorest and the weakest man on this planet, believe me, one day that company will become extremely successful. And never aim for a project for a rich man, only serving the rich people, because rich people can run faster than you. Rich people always walk the path beaten by the poor people. Always try to build products for the poor people. You're all coming from the business school. I just want to ask you a question. The most expensive watch called Breguet, or for example, Omega, you know, Breguet watch costs more than a Ferrari car. Do you know which company owns it? Any idea? You heard of a cheap watchmaker called Swatch? Swatch owns it. It's not the Breguet owning Swatch, it's Swatch owning Breguet. So the moral of the story is, Toyota started as a poor man's car in the US, and they became the world's largest automobile company. So any product, any service you want to create, look at the needs of the common man. And that is the best business advice I can give it to you. In your life, one important lesson you will learn soon, that you're going to fail more often than succeed. The things what you thought you will 100% get it, you will not get it. And then you think it's the end of the world. When I went to England, I went with the idea that I will work in the periphery. Then I was virtually guaranteed a registrar job at the Southampton Hospital after 1 year, because my boss knew the boss there and they fixed the job for me. At the end of a year, I went for the interview, knowing fully well that the registrar job is mine. But unfortunately, there was somebody better than me. I didn't get the job. Those days, there was no mobile phone. I called my wife from the railway station, and I told her that, honey, our term is over in England. We have to pack up and go back to India with 2 kids. She said, what happened? I said, I didn't get this job. She just laughed and said, God has something better for you. Exactly a week later, I got the offer from Guy's Hospital, London, which is considered as the best cardiac center in Europe. I never thought I will get the job. I never even applied for the job. Remember, when you don't get something, God always has something better for you. Just want to tell you about Kiran. Kiran always wanted to become a doctor. Did you know that? You read so much about her. She always wanted to become a doctor. She always thought, took it for granted that she will get admission to one of the Bangalore's prestigious medical college. But in the end, she didn't get it. I'm sure she was disappointed. She was devastated. Then she thought, maybe if I can't become a doctor, let me at least make some medicines for the patients. And that's it. She created Biocon. And what is the impact of Biocon? Today, 61 million people in this country who are suffering from diabetes can afford insulin only because of Kiran. So we all should thank God, and the country should thank God that Kiran didn't get into medical college. Because if she got into medical college, she would have been a gynecologist treating few patients or a pediatrician. And because she didn't become a doctor, she created something which every one of us are proud of. When you create your own enterprise, you have to behave like a thief. Now, not in the real sense. My boss, who taught me how to do cardiac surgery, my mentor, Professor Alan Yates, he was telling me about, he taught me about heart surgery and life and everything else. He said, Devi, when you open the chest, you should always behave like a thief. And I was confused. Then he looked at my eyes and he said, do you know what a thief does when he enters a house? Do you know what a thief, when he enters your house to burgle, you know what they do? First thing, they keep the back door open so that if you wake up, they can run away without getting caught. So when you open somebody's chest to do the heart operation, even if you're not able to do what you want to do, don't hurt him. And when you start a business, always keep the back door open. If something doesn't work out, that is not the end of the world. Tomorrow you're not standing on the street with nothing. Always in life, keep the back door open. And in life, you will fail. You will fail many, many times. And Winston Churchill was asked about the secret sauce, how he steered the Allied forces to victory in such difficult circumstances. And he gave the shortest speech, one of the most powerful speech. And the content of the speech was, never, never, never give up. So in life, you will fail. You will fail many, many times and never give up. Failure is part of life. Do you know who's the safest surgeon? Do you know who's the safest surgeon? Safest surgeon is the one who doesn't operate. If you operate, somebody is going to die. Just because somebody is going to die, you're not going to stop yourself from operating on 99% of the people who are going to live. So just because you are going to fail, or you may fail, it shouldn't prevent you from taking the risk. Whatever business you create, always keep an eye on the money. Money is like oxygen. The purpose of life is not oxygen. But without oxygen, you will not survive for more than 3 minutes. So whatever you create, try to have a system wherein we have invested heavily on technology. We have 29 hospitals across the country. Every day by 10 o'clock, all our senior doctors, senior administrators get a SMS on their mobile phone with the previous day's revenue, expenses, and the EBITDA margin. For us, looking at the profit and loss account at the end of the month is like reading a postmortem report. You can't do anything about it. Whereas looking at the profit and loss account on a daily basis is a diagnostic tool that will help you to steer the company in the right direction, because money doesn't grow on the trees. Another important lesson I would like to tell you is about the life. When things are going wrong, remember, things are never as bad as it looks like. You have a company in the US and somebody files a case for $200 million against you, and you get the lawyer notice. You think it's the end of the world. You have to sell your company, you have to sell your house. Believe me, things are never as bad as it looks like at the first when you encounter the situation. On the contrary, you got the fantastic job, you beat all the big companies in the world, and you got a phenomenal job, and the contract is in your hand. Believe me, it is never as great as it looks like. There is always something in between. There is always something in between. When you have a problem, you go by the norms. Whatever is the norm, you try to make 10% here and 10% there and try to make some difference. There are 100 towns in India with a population of 500,000 to 1 million where there is no super specialty heart hospital or a cancer hospital, because they can't afford that. People can't afford it because it costs about $20 million to build a 300-bed super specialty hospital. So what do? Do you allow the people to die, or you do something else? So we decided, we had a discussion with L&T, which is India's largest construction company, that we want to build a super specialty hospital for $6 million. Normally it costs $20 million. And it takes 3 years to build a super specialty hospital. We want to build it in 6 months. And L&T made the project. This is the blueprint. And sure enough, we built it in a place called Mysore. And it has happened, it is serving people. All it happened because we never took anything for granted. It is an illusion that every hospital should be centrally air-conditioned. Central air-conditioning doesn't prevent infection in a hospital. In fact, it is a common source of infection. The best sanitizer for a hospital is fresh air and sunlight. And modern hospitals do not allow the fresh air and sunlight to come. So this is an example for anything you want to do. Always look at some other way. Now the lesson I would like to tell you, that whatever you do, be spiritual. I'm not saying you should be religious. Separate religion from God. Be spiritual. Believe in God. Every day I take 3 to 5 people to the brink of death and I bring them back. And if these people survive and go home, never give me the credit. Before I start the operation, I pray to God, and I finish the operation, pray to God for taking me through the operation. I am like a surgical instrument in my hand, in the hands of God. So are you. And if you ever think I am in control of my destiny, you are mistaken. It is somebody else on top who knows what's good for you. He will protect you, and he will always be with you. be techno savvy. It is, I'm sure all of you are techno savvy. I think I should be talking to the parents behind you. It's very important in the near future, not being able to use a mobile phone and the apps and the devices, you're as good as illiterate. You will go to a railway station or airport, you will not be able to check in. You go to a supermarket, there will not be anybody at the teller counter. People expect you to do everything yourself. I wasn't a techno savvy person about 10 years ago. My wife insisted that I should learn how to use technology. For me, mobile phone had only two buttons, the green button for taking the phone and red button for disconnecting. And she taught me how to send messages. And I started sending messages. When you are learning technology, you make mistakes. And I kept on sending messages to my wife. What message you give it to your wife? So I started messaging, "I love you, honey." And she would respond, "Yes, honey, I love you too." And it went on like that for a few days. And she would check how I was getting better. One day when I was home, she looked at the mobile phone. And she got so angry, she banged the phone on the table. I didn't know what the hell happened. Then I realized that I sent the "I love you" message to the matron of the hospital. This can happen. When you are learning technology, you will make mistakes. But that shouldn't prevent you from learning. One day, you are going to create a billion-dollar company. And you have $1 billion in hand. What are you going to do with $1 billion? Are you going to buy a fleet of Ferraris and Mercedes and a house worth 200 crore rupees? When that happens, I want you to remember this simple message. God did not create everyone alike. He gave the wisdom of creating wealth to very few people. But He also gave them the responsibility of looking after the less privileged ones. Remember, all the wealth you got, you're only a trustee. You're not an owner. The wealth belongs to the society. And the society has made you as a trustee. And your responsibility is to ensure that it is distributed and given to the society which has trusted you with all the wealth. Just want to give you another simple message. Irrespective of what you want to do, remember, charity is not scalable. Never give anything to someone free because it's a matter of time before you run out of your money. According to me, do you know which is the most charitable company or organization in the world? Especially in a country like India, it's a mobile phone company. Because they are the that's a company which believed in serving the needs of the poor people. And they took the risk of putting mobile phone in the hands of everybody, including the beggars. And they made money out of it. And this is the greatest charity you can do. Charity, we should change the definition of charity. Charity is not about giving something free to the people. Charity is giving something to people at a price what they can afford. And this is what charity is about. I've been given 20 minutes. It's getting over. This is the last lesson I would like to tell you. How many of you are married? Yeah. I'm sure quite a few are in the process of getting married. 10 years from now, when you're all married, having one or two kids, you do go through introspection. You find out the shortfalls of your wife or the spouse. A typical husband always feels that, "I wish my wife was a little bit more understanding. I wish she was like this. I wish she was like that." Without really realizing that the wife is also thinking about the same thing about the husband. So I have a simple trick for successful wedding. You have to tell your wife or your spouse that, "You're not okay, I'm not okay, that's okay." Just want to, I can't help myself, around 8 years ago, when the government of India, maybe 9 years ago, when Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, one of the best statesmen we had in the country, was the finance minister, the finance budget had 5% service tax. 5% service tax means people who sell their house and come up with 1 lakh rupees for a heart operation were expected to write another check for 5,000 rupees to the government as a service tax, because living in a country which doesn't provide heart surgery, they sell their house, come for the operation, then for being penalty for being living in this country, they were supposed to pay 5 lakh rupees. So we talked to our friends, we mobilized everybody, and we called it as a misery tax. It was ridiculous for people like us to stand on the street with a placard saying that this is not service tax, this is misery tax. And we had the privilege of meeting the finance minister at 11 o'clock night. He called me saying that, yes, we understand, we are going to withdraw the misery tax. All I am trying to say is that this world is not ruined by the activity of the bad people. This world is ruined because of the inactivity of the good people. And I assume you're all good people, and don't ruin this world. Thank you very much, and I'm extremely grateful to you for the opportunity.